like to welcome you to Harvard Bookstore for tonight's event with Sam Kean, who is joining us to discuss his new book, The Tale of the Dueling Neurosurgeons, The History of the Human Brain as Revealed by True Stories of Trauma, Madness, and Recovery. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Sam Kean. Kean is the author of the best-selling books, The Disappearing Spoon and The Violinist's Thumb. His work has been featured on numerous NPR programs, including Radiolab, All Things Considered, and Fresh Air. His latest book explores the early studies on the functions of the human brain. Scientists had a very simple method for mapping the brain's functions. They would wait for misfortune to strike and record how the victims would cope. Kean recounts forgotten stories of ordinary people whose struggles, resiliency, and humanity went on to make modern neuroscience possible. We are very delighted to be hosting him tonight. Please join me in welcoming Sam Kean.
Well, hello everyone. Thank you all for joining me tonight. So people often want to know what inspired someone to write a book. And I can say with this book, what inspired me to write it was disbelief. Skepticism, mistrust, whatever you want to call it. Because a few years ago, I was reading about some people who had suffered damage to part of their brain, and their behavior changed afterward in kind of an unusual way. And I was reading this, and I just said to myself, you know, bull sugar. I said, there is no way that that could possibly be true. I do not believe that. So I forgot about it for a bit. And then a few weeks later, I started reading another kind of similar story. And again, I said to myself, baloney. I do not believe that this is true. I mean, I write about some strange science things, but I do not believe this story. So this book sort of arose of me trying to get to the bottom of whether or not this was true. So what kind of stories were these? You know, I think we've all heard stories of people suffering an injury to part of the brain, and then they become paralyzed on half their body, or they can't speak, or they maybe lose their memory, something like that. So it wasn't those type of stories, because I was familiar with those. It was stories of people losing something startlingly specific that really got to me. For instance, I think we all know generally what kind of animals are pictured here. You know, maybe not exactly, but we could all generally classify them. But if you get injured in one part of your temporal lobe on the side of the brain, if it gets nicked in the exact right spot, all knowledge of animals will disappear from your head completely. And when this happens to people, they can still recognize plants just fine. They can recognize man-made objects. They can recognize faces. All of that's okay. But animals, you know, cats, dogs, elephants just look exactly the same to them. They cannot tell these animals apart whatsoever. Or sometimes sort of the opposite things happen, where people suddenly, you know, we all know what kind of plants these are, but suddenly people can't recognize any sort of plant. Potatoes, carrots, pineapples, all of it looks exactly the same to them. They cannot tell them apart. And so when I was looking into the reasons why these sorts of things happen, I realized, oh, it kind of has to do with the history of the brain. You know, back in the ancient days of our species, people who could recognize plants, who could recognize animals and sort of classify them as, you know, as prey, predators, beasts of burden, things like that, these people kind of had an advantage. And eventually we got sort of specialized circuitry inside of our brains that is dedicated to recognizing animals. The flip side of that, of the having specialized circuitry, is that if it gets injured, then all that knowledge can evaporate from your brain completely. So learning about this injury kind of gave me an insight into how the brain works, which I thought was kind of cool. The other story that I was interested in was even more unusual, I thought. Again, we've probably all heard stories of people who've suffered damage to part of their brain and suddenly they can't speak anymore. But there are some cases where the language center in the brain is actually okay, but a stroke or whatever wipes out the connections between the language center and the muscles that move your mouth. So it's just the connections that are broken, whereas the language center itself could still function. And one important lesson of neuroscience is that there are a lot of different ways to route information around the brain. Sometimes there are back alleys that don't go directly between two spots, but go through an indirect path. So, for instance, there might be a path from the language centers of the brain to the emotional centers of the brain, and then to the muscles that move the mouth. So again, the direct connection's broken, but there's still this sort of back alley. So if you're trying to have a conversation with the people with these sorts of damage, you know, they can't respond to you, they can't speak. But if you engage them, if you provoke them, if you get their emotions going, they will actually start to swear at you. They will just erupt into swear words. And, you know, they say you beepity beep, and then they kind of cover their mouth afterward because they're sort of startled that this happened. They didn't expect this to happen either. It sort of just bubbled up from their unconscious. But it's a well-recognized symptom that sometimes people can't talk, but they can still swear. Another example, there are some people who cannot speak at all again, but there are indirect connections between the language centers of your brain, the parts of the brain that process music, and then your teeth, tongue, and lips. So these people, even though they can't speak, they can still sing just fine, which sounds like it should not be possible, but it happens to these people. And in fact, Congresswoman Gabrielle Giffords in Arizona, she got shot in the head a few years ago. She lost the ability to speak right afterward, but she learned how to speak again by singing songs to herself, including songs like Girls Just Wanna Have Fun. I don't know why that was the song that helped her out, but that was one of the songs she sang, and eventually she retrained her brain to be able to speak again. And so when I was hearing all of these stories, at some point I realized, you know, that they aren't just anecdotes. They actually really provide insight into how the brain is organized, how it evolved, and how it worked. And I was sitting there sort of daydreaming one day, and I thought, boy, you know, I bet you could write a whole history of the brain just based on different injuries and what, you know, different injuries prevent people from doing. And then sort of a cartoon light bulb went off over my head, and I said, oh, I should write a book about those kind of things. So that's really where the inspiration for this book came from, was from these tales of injuries. So until the past few decades, scientists really only had one way to study the human brain. They would wait for disaster to strike people and then see how their behavior changed afterward. Sometimes these were tumors or gunshots or rabies or botched lobotomies, things like that. And there are some really miraculous tales of people recovering out there from these terrible accidents. But in a lot of cases, even though their bodies recovered, their minds didn't recover, not quite. Their minds were somehow skewed or warped or off a little bit. Some people lost all fear of death, or they started lying incessantly. Parents couldn't recognize their children suddenly. But each case offered vital clues about what that part of the brain did. And virtually all the major discoveries in the history of neuroscience came about this way, through stories of injury. And that's why stories are probably more important to neuroscience than any other scientific field out there. So I'm happy to be able to share a few of my favorite stories with you tonight. So I'm going to start with something sort of visceral. Start with emotions. And talking about emotions, you have to deal with the limbic system. So we're going to talk about something that might provoke an emotion inside you, like if you were confronted with a tiger, something like that. So if that happened, various structures in your brain would start to fire. And you know, you don't have to worry about all the details here, but just a general overview of what happens if you were to see a tiger right in front of you. That information is coming in through your eyes and through your ears. And that sensory information goes first into the thalamus, which is in yellow in the center of the brain. That's sort of a relay center. So it takes that information in and it starts sending it to different parts of the brain, divides it into different streams. One of those streams goes into what's called the hippocampus, the arrow down there at the bottom. Hippocampus is very involved with memory, and I'll be talking a little bit more about the hippocampus a little bit later. Another one of those streams goes into the amygdala, the little blue bit right there. The amygdala is involved in processing all emotions generally, but its real purpose is to say, so what? So I see this thing in front of me, you know, so what? Should I care about it? And you know, in this case, it would look and it would say, okay, those are some big teeth. It's coming at me. I should probably care about what's going on in front of me. So when that happens, the amygdala alerts what's called the hypothalamus, which is there sort of on the left-hand side. And that's one of the busiest beavers in the body, because it's really the interface between the brain and body. Once the amygdala makes the call of we should care about this, the hypothalamus gets engaged and it will say, okay, we need to do something. It really gets the body revved up, gets it going. So that's just a general idea of how emotions work. Your senses take in information, your brain does something, makes your body react in some way. But this process can go awry sometimes. So this story involves a woman who was born in Iowa in the 1960s. She's known as SM in the medical literature, but I'm just going to call her Sarah. So when Sarah was young, she felt fear normally, just like all of us. For instance, she remembered being cornered by a Doberman once in her neighbor's house, and it was barking at her. She felt her stomach sort of lurch, and her heart was pounding, kind of a normal fear response. There was another time when her brother lured her into a graveyard at midnight and then sort of hid behind a tombstone and jumped out at her. You know, she screamed, she got scared. Again, a normal fear response. But when she was about 10 or 11 years old, Sarah came down with a disease that started destroying the cells in her amygdala. And by the time she was in her early 20s, her doctor said she had two black holes where her amygdala should be. So all of the amygdala cells were basically destroyed. And since that time, Sarah has not felt a lick of fear. And actually reading some of the studies about Sarah are kind of a hoot, because the scientists are basically trying to think up ever more elaborate ways to scare her. So they'll, for instance, drive her to an exotic pet store where they had a bunch of snakes, and they'll expose her to these snakes. And on the drive over there, Sarah was like, you know, I don't really know that I like snakes that much. They're just not my thing. But as soon as she got there, Sarah practically ran up to the snakes, grabbed them out of the people's hand, and was holding them, you know, watching the snakes. She kept petting them. She kept asking if she could hold the venomous snakes on hand. She was staring in their eyes, and she kept trying to grab the snake's tongue when it would flick at her. And you know, I'm no reptile expert, but I'm pretty sure snakes do not like having their tongues grabbed. They do not react well to that. But she just wouldn't stop doing this. Another case, they brought Sarah to a haunted house, and they paired her up with kind of five other people. They were kind of the control group. Sent them through the haunted house. So in this old lunatic asylum. So there were a lot of creaking doors and kind of dark places for you know, monsters to hide out in, things like that. The other people in the group were screaming all the time, you know, running over, covering their eyes, but Sarah didn't care. She was always running ahead to see what was next, what she could find out new. And at one point, actually, a monster jumped out from behind something and sort of waved its arms. It was an actor in a costume, obviously, but waved its arms. Sarah didn't blink. Sarah didn't care. And in fact, she got kind of interested in the monster's mask. It had some sort of blood on it. She wanted to know what it felt like, what it felt like. So she went up to the monster and she kind of lunged at the monster, and she ended up scaring the monster. This is how fearless this woman was. But you know, these were good skeptical scientists, so they had a pretty good idea that the amygdala was what was causing this problem inside her, obviously. But they wanted to make sure that there weren't possibly other things going on. So what they did, they said, well, you know, maybe it's not that she can't recognize, or that she can't feel fear. Maybe she's just sort of blunted to all emotions. So they wanted to check and see if there were other emotions that she couldn't feel. So they started playing her movie clips. But no, it turned out she could, you know, she was happy at the right time. She was sad at the right time, disgusted at the right time, so she could feel other emotions. So that was a big insight, that the amygdala is involved in processing a lot of emotions, but other emotions can apparently bypass the amygdala. They can get around the amygdala through some of those alternative connections. Fear, though, apparently, fear really needs the amygdala, or else you can't feel it. So that was one of the good big insights they got from doing this study on Sarah. There are the snakes. So. The other thing the scientists realized is, okay, you know, she didn't have any fears in the haunted house, but you're really not in danger inside a haunted house. Or even in the snake story, you're not really in danger of your life in this situation. Were there any real life situations where she actually showed no fear? And there, in fact, was a situation, what I call the knife incident. So Sarah was walking home one day in the dark, alone, already a bad idea. She decided she was going to cut through this unlit park near a church. So she's walking through there, and what she described as a drugged out man was sitting over on a bench in the distance, yelled out, said, "Come over here." So Sarah said, "Okay, that's a good idea." And she walked over to this man. He jumped up, grabbed a knife, turned around, and was holding the knife to her throat suddenly. And they later asked Sarah what she was experiencing, what she was feeling at this moment. And she said, well, you know, it was kind of inconvenient. She didn't like it very much. And she was kind of angry a little bit about it. But she never recalled feeling any fear. This situation, her life was actually in danger, but she never recalled feeling any fear. And finally, there was a moment of silence, and she said to the man, you know, "I'm not afraid. God's angels will protect me." And at this point, the man got a little weirded out, and he pulled the knife back. And instead of running away, Sarah just kind of walked away and just kept going on with her business. And the next day, she was back in the park. She just didn't care. This woman was incapable of feeling fear. And I really think the big insight that Sarah provides, based on all of these stories about her, is that there are really two steps involved in feeling fear. There's the part where we fixate on something, and then there's our bodily reaction to it. And it kind of makes sense that this would be the case. I mean, if you were, you know, an ancient human being, you know, out in the jungle or something, and you saw a snake there on the ground, you want to pay close attention to that snake. You don't want to say, okay, there's a snake, that's dangerous, but then be like, oh, that monkey over there is kind of interesting, and oh, that's like a very nice cloud over there. Like, no, you want to focus on the snake. You don't want to lose track of the snake. So again, you fixate on something, and then you feel a bodily response, fear, wanting to run away, wanting to fight it, something like that. And in most of us, those two things happen one after the other. We can't even really separate them. And Sarah was still feeling that first response because, I mean, remember, when she got a hold of the snake, she was really excited. When she was in the haunted house, she was excited to see the monster. When she saw the man over there that she should have been afraid of, she was excited. She still was able to fixate on things that scared her. Her brain, though, wasn't taking the next step. It wasn't giving her the bodily reaction that should have made her get the heck out of there. So we were really able to tease apart these two steps based on this story of Sarah. And I really think that there's even a bigger insight into how fear and emotions generally work inside our brain based on these kind of stories. Because you could legitimately criticize Sarah in this case and say, you know, instead of having black holes in her amygdala, maybe she just kind of had a hole in her head. Like, it doesn't sound like she had much common sense. Like, she just doesn't seem like she's the sharpest tool. But I think that really misses the point of what's going on here. And that is, when it comes to fear and keeping us safe, fear is common sense. Fear is what gives us common sense in the first place. And I think that's a really interesting insight. Because normally we think about our rational brain being in charge of everything. But one of the big themes of neuroscience of the past few decades is that it's not always our rational brain in charge. And then, in fact, our unconscious brain, our emotions, other things, are really what are driving a lot of our decisions, even if we're not aware of it. I heard a metaphor one time that I thought really captured this very nicely. The man compared a brain to an elephant with someone on top kind of driving it left and right, kind of trying to steer it. You know, he had a switch and he was saying, ha, ha, and you know, making it go left and right, stuff like that. And he said the brain is a lot like that. And the rational brain is like the person sitting on top of the elephant. And the person thinks he's driving the elephant left and driving the elephant right and stuff like that. But we all know if that elephant wanted to go left instead of right, the elephant's gonna go left instead of right. The man on top is really not that in charge of the elephant. And it's kind of that way with the brain, too. The rational brain is there and it has some control, but a lot of the power of the brain is coming from underneath, from the unconscious things like our emotions. And Sarah's a very, very clear example of this, because when it comes to keeping us alive, again, fear is common sense. And without fear, she wasn't behaving rationally. And I think that's a fascinating insight because we do normally think of emotion as interfering with reason, as getting in the way of reason. But in this case, without emotion, Sarah was not able to act rationally. So we normally think about ourselves as Homo sapiens, as the thinking ape or the wise ape, but we are feeling apes as well. And without both of those things, without the thinking and without the emotion, you can't really be fully human. So again, that was sort of this kind of visceral thing, emotions in our body. But now I wanted to jump to kind of the highest level of the brain and talk a little bit about consciousness and what we know about consciousness in the brain. And you know, again, it's kind of the highest part of the brain that we think about consciousness, but it too is also built on brain circuits. And if those brain circuits get damaged, your consciousness can go awry in kind of unusual ways. So this story involves this man right here, a man named Clive Wearing. He was a musician active in London in the 1970s, 1980s, classical musician, very well known. When they needed to do the BBC score for the broadcast of Charles and Diana's wedding, Clive was the person they called. So very well known, very well connected. But about 1985, he came down with the flu one day. And you know, he just wasn't getting better from this flu, feeling achy all the time. Doctor told him to get some rest, take some fluids, but just not getting better. In fact, he got worse. He started to feel confused. He went outside one day, started wandering around, got in a taxi, couldn't remember his address. His wife had to come get him eventually at the police station. They finally got Clive into the hospital, where they realized that he wasn't suffering from a flu, but he had an infection inside his brain. So he had an infection of what's called the herpes virus, and it's not the STD, but it's related to it. It's actually the virus that causes cold sores. So if you've had a cold sore, this is the same virus. And I don't mean to alarm anyone, it's rare, but every once in a while, one of these cold sore bugs, these herpes virus, they go rogue, and they start to migrate up the olfactory nerve, the smell nerve, into the brain, and once they get there, they start wreaking havoc. The people at the beginning who couldn't recognize plants and animals, they also suffered from an infection of the herpes virus in their brain. Clive didn't suffer from that deficit, but the herpes virus did do a lot of damage to his limbic system, including to his hippocampus, the part of the brain that I mentioned that's really involved with memories. So Clive woke up and amnesiac. And when you're talking about amnesiacs, you know, that you, when you see it on television or something, they lose everything. They don't remember their name. They don't remember anything about themselves. Real amnesiacs aren't quite like that. They do retain some things. They retain a lot of motor memories, for instance. So they can still ride a bicycle. They can usually still sign their name. And they might remember a few things from their past. Like they might remember the rules to a card game they played as a kid or something like that. But what really gets damaged is they can't form new memories going forward. Just absolutely no ability to do that. And in fact, Clive was the most profound case of amnesia that scientists have ever recorded. They have never seen a worse case of amnesia than the amnesia that Clive had. For instance, he would be playing solitaire or something, and he would blink, and the cards would seem to have rearranged themselves. His memories couldn't last from the beginning of a blink to the end of a blink. Or he might just be sitting there, you know, talking with someone who had a green shirt on or something. And he would look away for a moment and look back, and their shirt would seem to have changed color. His memories couldn't even last as long as his sensory perceptions did. That's how bad this case of amnesia was. And in the book, I talk a little bit more about what it's like to live with this amnesia day after day, how it kind of messes with your sense of time, things like that. But right now, I'm going to focus a little bit more specifically on one aspect of the case, kind of an unusual aspect of the case. And that's because when Clive sort of lost his ability to tell the past from the present from the future, it had an unusual effect on his mind in that he kept thinking that he was becoming conscious for the first time. So he would be sitting there, and he would feel like he had just woken up for the very first time in his life. Like this moment right now was the very first time he had ever been awake or conscious in his entire life. And again, it sounds weird, but that's what the feeling was like. And it's not actually like he was going unconscious, like he was falling asleep or something like that. But as far as he knew, he had no past beyond this moment. This was the first moment of consciousness of being awake he'd ever experienced. And as you can imagine, it was kind of an exciting thing for him. If you imagine if you had just woken up right now, it would be an exciting moment for you to just become conscious for the first time. And in fact, what Clive started doing is he started recording this moment in his diary. He would grab it and he would say, 8:31, now I am really completely awake. 9:06, now I am perfectly, overwhelmingly awake. 9:34, now I am superlatively, actually awake. Moment after moment. And if he didn't have his diary at hand, he would grab a pen and he would write it on the walls or he would write it on the furniture just to be able to record this moment. But something strange you'll notice about these, they're crossed out. That's because every time he would get to the diary, he would look at the old entry and he could recognize, he could read the handwriting, but he would say, well, you know, that's clearly false because that was half an hour ago, but now is the first time I've ever been awake. So he would cross the old entry out and he would write a new entry. Then 20 minutes later, he would come back and he would say, well, that entry is clearly false because now I'm awake for the first time. And he would cross the old entry out and just keep going. He has dozens and dozens of diaries filled with pages like this, of just writing that now he'd become conscious, crossing it out, over and over. He's had this experience millions and millions of times in his life. And that's interesting because this doesn't happen to most amnesiacs. Most amnesiacs obviously don't remember their past very well, but they don't lose that sense of continuity through time. They don't pop awake like Clive felt like he was doing over and over. So scientists obviously want to know, well, why is this happening to Clive? What exactly is going on? And the answer is we don't quite know yet. We don't know exactly why the symptoms are rising in Clive, but not in other people. But we did get kind of one important insight into it, in that it must be something about the unique combination of damage in Clive's brain. Because there are other people who've had hippocampus damage like he did, but this didn't happen to them. Clive had some damage to the frontal lobe in the front of his brain, but again, this symptom didn't happen. So it must be something about the various structures that work together to produce consciousness. It must be the combination of damage. And the big insight from that is that consciousness isn't just a thing in a place in your brain. It's not like you have a little tiny consciousness spot, and if that spot gets hurt, then all of a sudden your consciousness goes on the blink. It's your entire brain working together. And for something profound to change about your consciousness, you have to have damage to a lot of different parts, the way it happened to Clive. So really, again, it's the combination of damage that was causing all of the problems. And that's an important insight into how consciousness works inside the brain. So I'm going to pause for the Clive story for a moment and come back to it. But now I'm going to look at another story involving kind of an unusual aspect of consciousness. This story took place in Vancouver, or a little outside Vancouver. A woman in about 2005 got pregnant, found out she was having twins, so she was excited about it. But during one of the ultrasounds, they found out that the twins were conjoined, what used to be called Siamese twins, so they were connected together. But she decided she was going to have the babies, and when she had them, as you can see in the picture here, they were conjoined at the head, so they shared a brain. And the girls are alive today. You know, they're normal, healthy, happy girls. So the story turned out okay for them. But they do have their brains connected. And because their brains are connected in a specific spot, they're showing some unusual behavior. Specifically, their thalamus is connected. That's the part of the limbic system I mentioned that takes sensory information in, and then it relays it to different parts of the brain. So because they share a thalamus, they have a bridge between their thalamus, the girls actually share sensory information. So what does that mean? Well, one girl could be taking a sip on a cup of juice, and the other girl will taste the juice in her mouth. Or they go to the doctor's office, they give a shot to one of the girls, and the other girl winces. They fall asleep together. They maybe even dream together. There was even one story, they were at a fast food restaurant, you know, they're kids, they're siblings, they fight, they were pushing each other, you know, flicking fries at each other, whatever. One girl reached up at one point and slapped the other girl in the face, and then immediately grabbed her own face in pain because she could feel the slap on her sister in her own face. So there's all these really interesting stories about how they're sharing this information between their brains. So in some sense, they're actually sharing a consciousness. They're sharing a sensory experience like this. So it's natural to ask the question, well, are they one person then, or are they two people if they're kind of sharing in the same consciousness? And you know, it's a little ambiguous, and you might never actually get a straight, complete answer. But I think the people who have been watching the girl's behavior can see that they are, in fact, two separate people. Every once in a while, one of the girls will come up to someone and say something like, I am just me, as if she's kind of asserting her independence. So apparently, deep inside her, she has some sort of need to assert herself as a unique individual. They also have distinct tastes. One of the girls, for instance, likes ketchup. She loves ketchup on her fries or hot dogs, whatever. Unfortunately, her sister hates ketchup, and so whenever she eats it, she tries to scrape it off her tongue and she gags. It's an unfortunate situation. But the insight is that they do have different tastes, different personalities like that. And even the sort of Three Stooges story about one girl slapping the other and grabbing her own face. You don't slap yourself if you get in a fight. You slap another person. So deep down, they were sort of defining themselves as two individual, as two separate people. And I think if you do look at it, you will see that they are two individual people, even though they share some aspects of consciousness. And now to circle back to Clive, again, his consciousness was on the blink, but there were some things about him that he retained, even though he was a complete amnesiac. One thing was he never lost the ability to play music. Sitting down and sight reading at the piano is a motor memory, a muscle memory, and he could still do that. But what was amazing about it was that when he would sit down to play, he would suddenly feel like himself again for the first time in as long as he could remember. Something about the momentum of the music, about the phrasing of the music, kind of kept him coherent, kept him unified in a way that nothing else really could. It reached down deep inside him, tapped something inside him, it tapped into his deepest personal identity. In a similar way, Clive was newlywed when he had the infection in his brain. And so he kind of retained a newlywed love of his wife, Deborah. He lives in an assisted living facility nowadays, and she comes and visits often, almost every day. And every time she gets there, he jumps up and down and says, "Deborah, Deborah, I love you. It's been so long since I've seen you. Why do you never visit me?" She says, "Hello, Clive," and she puts her bag down and then goes to the bathroom, comes back a minute later. He jumps up again and says, "Deborah, Deborah, I love you. It's been so long since I've seen you." And this just happens over and over and over. And she admits sometimes she has a little trouble working up the enthusiasm for, the 10,000th time he's so excited to see her like this. But it is a really touching moment because he's tapping into something that will never abandon him, his love for his wife, and that he will never abandon. That core part of him is still intact deep inside him. So he never lost a sense of who he was deep down. And I think that's a really big, important insight into what's going on in his brain. He's often bewildered or helpless, but his sense of who he was remained intact. And sort of like the elephant metaphor, we often think about our consciousness as being in charge of our brain, but it's not always the most fundamental, deepest part of it. Because you can share a consciousness with another person, like the twins did, and yet still retain a personal identity. Your consciousness can go on a blink, and your memory can be wiped out, but you're not going to forget who you are deep down. Your sense of self is really tenacious. And I think there's something kind of reassuring in that. So there are a lot of stories in the book about people from all walks of life. There are stories about Dostoevsky and how he would see flashes of God. There are stories about Woodrow Wilson and some of the neurological disorders he suffered from while he was in office. There are stories of Phineas Gage, the man who got the railroad spike blown through his head, who's maybe the most maligned man in medical history. But in a lot of these cases, the heroes were everyday people. They were people like you, people like me, who just happened to suffer from some sort of brain injury. What happened to them could have happened to any one of us. And because of their accidents, their minds don't quite work like ours. But the real power of stories is that we can reach across that divide, and we can still connect with these people on a really basic, fundamental level. Because in a lot of cases, these people's brains still work like ours to a large extent. They have that one deficit, but they can still reason, they can still read, they can walk, they can talk, they can emote. They suffer the same disappointments and feel the same joys. They suffer the same bewilderment that, life kind of got away from them sometimes. They feel all of the same things that we do. And deepest of all, even when something really profoundly goes wrong in their brain, they still retain a sense of who they are. They retain a personal identity. And so would all of we if we were unfortunate enough to end up in that situation. We would not forget who we are deep down. That's really tenacious. It's really buried deeply inside you. And it's almost impossible to dislodge. So there's a lot of tales of injury and woe in this book, I know. But even deeper than that, there's a lot of resiliency in the book. And I really think that's the fundamental lesson of the book. And I think seeing that resiliency just kind of requires us to flip our imaginations a little bit. It's kind of like an optical illusion. You know, you can focus on one part of it or you can focus on another, and it'll suddenly flip like that. And when you're talking about these stories of people with deficits, it's easy to focus on the deficits. But if you focus on what they retain, how they recover over time, what they were able to still accomplish despite the brain damage, these stories about deficits flip. And they become stories about courage and resiliency and other things like that instead. And that's really how the book grows from beginning to end, is showing all of these tales of courage and resiliency. As I said at the beginning, stories probably mean more to neuroscience than any other scientific field out there. And I really think above all what these stories do is help us understand what it means to be fully human. And I was happy to be able to share some of my favorite stories with you tonight. So thank you all for coming out. So she asked about the title of the book, Dueling Neurosurgeons, where it came from. So this story is from the very early days of neuroscience. There was a king of France named Henry II who was kind of a big macho guy, and he liked to joust, like lances on horses. And he got into a jousting accident one day where he got clobbered in the face, fell off his horse, really suffered a big head injury. So naturally they called in the most prestigious, the best two neuroscientists in Europe. One of them named Andreas Vesalius, one of them named Ambrose Pare, to attend to the king. And they diagnosed him with something that was kind of controversial at the time, because when you looked at Henry's head, there was no fracture, nothing had opened up, he wasn't bleeding or anything, you couldn't see things oozing out. His head looked intact. But Pare and Vesalius said, we think he suffered from a concussion. That was a very new diagnosis. No one had really heard of it at the time. But they were the ones kind of pushing this idea that inside the brain you can still suffer damage even though the skull itself doesn't show obvious signs of trauma. So the story is kind of about the early days of neuroscience and what they were learning about the brain and how it kind of foreshadowed a lot that was going to come over the next few centuries. And I think it's a good it's good for the title because we're still dealing with a lot of these situations today, because we hear about, you know, football players, hockey players, people suffering from concussions, and because there's nothing obviously wrong with their skull, they say, oh, I'll go out there again, I must be fine. People are relearning these lessons, unfortunately, over and over even today. So I think it shows the beginning of neuroscience and then it kind of goes through to the today and shows how there's still connections between the two. So she asked about perceiving pain and how we perceive it. There's one chapter actually about phantom limbs in the book and how those work with the brain, because I didn't know this before I started researching it. I've heard of phantom limbs, you know, you get a limb chopped off, you can still feel your fingers. But a lot of times people feel cramps in their phantom limbs, or they feel shooting pains. And they know it doesn't make sense because the limb's not there, but they can still feel the pain. It's often very excruciating. So I do talk about how pain arises in the brain and why it kind of arises in the brain, specifically in the context of phantom limbs, but just kind of generally how pain works in the brain, why it's kind of internal to the brain, things like that. Yeah, so she asked how I did my research, how I learned about it. It was a lot of hunting through footnotes is what it was, just putting lots and lots of hours in, really studying up on it and figuring out what stories I wanted to tell, what parts of the brain I wanted to dive into, how I could capture all of this stuff, things like that. So a lot of hours in the library studying these things, these historical cases, and then talking to scientists, figuring out what they're interested in, what's going on with them, calling them, emailing them, things like that. So kind of a combination of those things. There's a few so we asked about when you have the phantom limb, why you can look and see it's missing, why doesn't your brain know it's missing? So your brain knows it's missing visually. physically, it doesn't necessarily know that, in part because you still have a stump there that has nerve endings in it. And those nerve endings, if those get excited, the brain thinks, the parts of the brain that deal with touch sensation still think it's coming from the tips of your fingers or whatever. We also have in our brain sort of this hardwired mental scaffold where we expect to find four full limbs. Like our brain, that's just the default situation. And we know that because there are stories of people who were born without limbs. They never had limbs, but they can still feel them. There was, in fact, one story of a girl who was in school. She didn't have either forearm, but when she was doing math, she would do math on her phantom fingers, like do arithmetic on it, even though she'd never had a forelimb in her life. So the body just expects to find it there, and it's kind of hard to dislodge that. And there's also some other things I talk about brain mapping, and when a part of your brain goes down, another part might take it over and kind of keep those circuits revving, different things like that. So there's actually a lot of different parts that play into it. So she asked about the fear parts of the brain and why common sense didn't kind of override it and prevent it from happening. One important fact is that the limbic system, the emotional parts of your brain, actually send lots of information to the frontal lobes, the parts of your brain that are dealing with planning, with reason, things like that. There are massive, massive connections between the two parts of your brain. And if those get shut down, then you're not having the interplay between them. So that part of her brain was actually disconnected. There was not information getting from the rational parts of her brain to the emotional parts of her brain. So even though she might recognize on some level that she should be afraid of something, there was just no part of her brain that was able to kind of dislodge her and get her going because she was so fixated, she was so excited. So as much as anything, it was the fact that she was excited about it and the part of her brain that normally would give feedback and say, okay, I know you're excited, but we should get out of here while we have a chance, that part of the brain just wasn't able to get her going. So again, on some level, she did recognize that a snake or something might be dangerous. On the car ride over, she said, you know, I'm not really sure I like snakes. But in the moment, that other emotion was overriding it. The excitement was overriding it. The rational parts of her brain really weren't able to dislodge that. He asked about how Sarah's doing, and as far as I know, she's doing okay. She's anonymous in the literature, so it would be hard to follow up or get in touch with her. And I've never worked with her or anything like that. So he asked about personalities, type A, type B personalities, things like that. I do go into personality somewhat in toward the end of the book, not necessarily type A versus type B, but in the context of Phineas Gage, the man who had the railroad spike blown through his head. He's probably the most famous case in neuroscience history, but a lot of people get the wrong story about what happened to him. A lot of people hear that, you know, he was a criminal or that he turned into a drunk and started brawling all over the place. There's actually no evidence that ever happened. There's actually some good evidence that he recovered later in life. But the reason Phineas Gage is so important is because his personality did change somehow. And he was the first clear case of someone getting injured in a specific part of the brain, his frontal lobes, and the personality changing dramatically afterward. So I do go into a little bit about what parts of the brain are involved in personality, what the damage did to him, and you know how it sort of applies to other people as well. So she asked about languages, first and second languages. And you're right, if you have a stroke in a certain part of your brain or other damage, you can lose one language you speak, but not the other language you speak. So they are kind of stored in different circuits in your brain. I also talk a little bit about some of the differences between acquiring languages, because the first language you learn when you're very young, that enters your unconscious, your motor memories, actually. So it's very deeply inside you. Whereas when you learn a language in school, it's more like you're trying to remember facts and things like that. So you don't store them in your brain in the same way, which is why one comes so obviously and naturally, and you have to think really hard about the other one. So I do talk about that and how emotions tied in with language. People often coo to babies in their first language because it's more tied up with their emotions, things like that. So there's a whole chapter about different ways of language affects your brain. So she asked about, you know, there are a lot of variations in circuitry, people suffer damage. Can we ever define a normal brain? And I think you could define sort of a platonically ideal normal brain, but no one individual will have that brain. So one of the things I was surprised to learn about was brains actually vary a lot where exactly the structures are inside them. So you think about your face. Everyone has the same basic features on their face, but everyone's face looks different. Brains are the same way. Same features on the surface, but they're arranged in different ways. Some are smaller, some are kind of spaced differently. So I don't think you could ever find one brain that was perfectly the average of everything. Everyone's going to be a little bit off in something. But in general, you can say that a language spot in your brain is here, and you know, parts that process vision are in the back of your brain, things like that. So he asked about if there's some link between hydration and concussions. And I have never heard that, any sort of link. I do know, actually, that if you do suffer a concussion, one of the problems is your brain might start swelling. So what a doctor will do is actually try to flush all of the liquids out of your system, or as many as they can, to keep your brain from swelling. But that's, again, kind of after the fact. Nothing necessarily about hydration before a concussion. There have been some cases where people suffered damage to, you know, stereotypically, you can take this too far, but we do have differences between our left brain and our right brain. The left brain is, you know, controls language, a little more logical, right brain a little more arty. So there were people who suffered damage to the left part of their brain, and it sort of freed up something in the right part of their brain where they suddenly loved painting for the first time. They didn't care a whistle about painting before, but now they love painting, or all of a sudden they appreciate poetry. It moves them in a way that it never did. So there are occasions where people will gain a new talent or a new sort of appreciation for something after brain damage. It's pretty rare, but it does happen. Yeah, so she asked about the twins and how they acquired language. I haven't heard too much about that. I don't think that there are a lot of scientific studies. I think they're still, the girls are pretty young still, so they're still, they can't quite describe their experiences well enough to get a lot. But I have heard some unusual things. One thing is that they use pronouns kind of oddly. They never say we. They always say, I am doing something. So they've, for instance, you hand one piece of paper to one girl, one piece of paper to the other girl, and the one girl will say, I have two pieces of paper. You turn to her sister and she says, I have two pieces of paper. So they use pronouns in kind of a weird way. And that's the one thing that really sticks in my mind is that use. But I haven't heard anything more specific than that. Yeah. So he asked about sort of the need between making it fun and enticing, but also making sure you're accurate with the science. And I really didn't find that there was too difficult with a book like this, because I do think neuroscience, just sort of, it's built in that there are a lot of story. It involves how people, you know, react to another face or how they use language, things like that. So it was just sort of intrinsically things that I think we'd all be interested in. And there is kind of a tension sometimes where you could go way too deep into a subject. But, you know, you just want to keep in mind that, you know, people reading this are coming to it maybe without a lot of knowledge about how these things work. One thing I did do in the book is I included some notes in the back. And there's a few cases I said, well, if you really want to geek out, here are the details of how exactly this works. And that's kind of a good balance of being able to give people more information if they want, but if you don't want that or you're not interested, you can kind of just keep going with the story how it is. So kind of separating the material out. But no, I didn't find it too much of a challenge to be able to give enough science to make sense of the story without it becoming overwhelming. They have done some, or should you ask about the twins, whether they have telepathy or something like that. They do have a sense where, obviously, you know, if one girl is drinking the juice or something, the other knows what's going on. They've also done things like, if you saw in the picture, they kind of face away from each other. So what one girl is seeing, the other can't see directly because they're looking each other way. But sometimes they've held a stuffed animal up in front of one girl and asked the other one what it was. And she didn't know immediately what it was, but She could say, you know, I'm kind of sensing that it's an animal and it will be a stuffed duck or something like that. So they do have something where, you know, it kind of tickles one brain and the other one can feel it. Maybe not outright telepathy, like sharing thoughts, but, you know, it's possible they could develop some sort of rudimentary ability to do that as their brains age. Yeah, so sharing the dream, they weren't sure they were doing that. They had a hint that they were doing that. They weren't sure about it. Sharing a dream, or a dream is more, I think, just sort of like sensations, whereas thoughts, I think, are a little more careful, a little more studied, something like that. A little less just kind of random and flashing through your mind.
Okay.